really close. Now, if the ladies will just get in there and sweep the floor, we'll be in good shape. The ladies have discussed the fact that maybe come September the 8th, we will have our first official potluck that we are going to resume in the future. So I'd like to welcome all of you and those of you that have not seen the outcome of where we're at now. You're welcome to look anytime you want. I think it's other than maybe a little dust here and there that you might find, just don't pick at the dust, just take it with you. So we're glad to be glad to get to completion of that particular project. And I'm not going to throw any numbers at you, but we have done extremely well as far as our expenses are concerned into comparison where we're where we could have been if we had contracted everything out completely. I know it's been a long ordeal. We've spent, 3 months now doing this project, but I think we've done extremely well in-house with all the procedures that we've done. With that, let me turn to opening our worship service this morning with a scripture reading that I'm going to read that I will take from Psalms chapter 121. I know that sometimes I may reread another one of the Psalms, but frequently we need to be reminded as to what the Lord has done for us. He says, I will lift up my eyes to the mountains. From whence shall come my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made the heavens and the earth. He will not allow our foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he keeps Israel, will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade in your right hand. The sun will not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all evil. Let me reread that. The Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your soul. The Lord will grant you going in and your going out from this time forth and forever. In other words, God is always with us. It doesn't matter what day, what time, or whether it's daytime or night. God will be with us. He will keep you from stumbling. Thank you, dear Father, for the blessings you've given to us. We thank you, Father, for all that you have provided. And we thank you especially, Father, for all of those that have put their labor forth in helping and volunteering at the Grace House. We know that this has been a project that has been long and hard, and but with patience we've been able to endure, and we thank you, Father, for your blessing. We especially thank you, Father, for your word, the word that guides us, the word that leads us into the salvation, the word that leads us to the opportunity that we can follow you and be your children. Thank you for each and every one here this morning, and we pray that you would be with us throughout our remainder of this worship as we sing praises to you and listen to the lesson. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, Hans walks back. I'm going to say just a few other things on grace up there. You said lots of people put lots of little time into it here, there, and yonder, but Hans and Linda have lived up here for 3 months. You know, being their upper 50s and stuff like that, they really do work hard. Right? Upper 50s, right? Something like that. but yeah, I've learned a whole lot from Hans, what not to do. No. but yeah, we can't say no thank you enough to Hans and Linda for all the time and expertise and stuff that they've done. So I think everybody's going to be really pleased with way things have come out and stuff. So looking forward to the last nail going in or whatever lacks right there. I know they are. Because they got like two houses to start on or something like that, right? One house to start on.
Their own, right? That's just their own stuff. Yeah.
So anyway, we welcome Grace Fellowship Church. It is summertime in Texas once again. And it's going to be worse this week. But it's okay. It's one day closer to fall, which doesn't mean anything in Texas. but it will be one day closer to winter, which will make a difference in January.
Let's stand. We're going to praise God. All the goodness is going to bring us rain. We're going to start off with Hosanna.
Return to you.
So much for your son Jesus died upon that cross for us, but once again rose on that third day, sits at your right hand interceding for us, and we can't say thank you enough that you loved us enough to do that for us. Lord, we just lift up today to you. We just pray that we could be pleasing to your sight. In Jesus' name I pray.
Teachers and administrators and nurses and doctors, folks, the whole understanding of assurance of God's blessing in your life and your profession, is it a God thing? Are you doing what God's asked you to do? Because there's enough difficult days, even whenever you do it for the right reason and the right purpose. But there certainly is if you're doing it just because it's a job. This is my profession. I'm doing it because I have to. No, we've seen this framed in the excellency of a minister that honors and glorifies God. It first starts with who appointed me, who commissioned me to this, who called me. And it's more than the right to do it. It's the desire to focus on the person who called you, the person who engaged in that calling. Well, i.e., for Paul and Timothy, it was God himself. And we reflected back to, really, chapter 2 and verse 7. And for this I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I'm telling the truth. I'm not lying. As a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. Paul says, Timothy, I'm just going to tell you how it started for me. It started the same for you. This was a commission from God. So as we see this framed, remember that. Because it's going to be difficult for us to get around that, because Paul's going to give exhortation this morning in the emphatic command. There's going to be some hard times in this. All right. Secondly, not only is it called or appointed by God, you can't do this in your flesh and glorify God. It's His appointment. It's His strength. If we try to operate any other way, it does not work. And it's more than pragmatism. If I want to be an excellent minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ according to the Word of God, not defined by men, but defined by Scripture, first, it is His appointment. Secondly, it's His strength. This cannot be a work of the flesh. And I said this last week, but I'm telling you again, if I operate as the pastor here in Ballinger in my flesh, we all lose. And you go walk away going, well, you know, that was great. Again, you're not here to judge the internal heart of the minister. But the motivation needs to be clear. There's a passion for God first in the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Who drives us? Who roots us? Who is the cause of our desire? Who is the focus of our motivation? It has to be God in Him alone. But lastly, guys, it's not enough to hear. Man, if in the early days, I used to think if I said it, they got it. And that's all that matters. I said it. Guys, I've heard this all the time. I go through weeks where we train teachers all week, and I just got through with 4 days of training teachers. And you know the number one thing that I hear when I go observe a teacher in the classroom and the test results aren't what we wanted. The formative assessment or the summative assessment at the end of the unit was not the intent the teacher thought they were going to get. And I've heard this a million times. Well, Rob, I taught it. I don't know. I don't know why they didn't get it. Really? Guys, it's not enough that we teach it. We have to do something with it. Or it's just another day where we were taught, we heard, and we left. And we've never been changed. Guys, the promise of God's word is this. Listen to me. It will change your life. But it only does that when I submit to it in faith for the one who taught me most. You remember those latter days with Jesus and his disciples? And they were weary from travel, 3+ years. It was hard. They left everything. Some of them left family. They all left their profession. And they never were the same again. But you remember that little caveat when we get to around John 13, and he says, "My hour has come for me to leave." And they're all like, what? I've been telling you for 3 years that I've got to go. You remember the only thing in chapter 14 that gave them any courage of hope? "I will send another one just like me." A parakletos, one who would come alongside, a servant, and lock arms with you. It won't be me, but it will be one just like me. I'm the second person of the Trinity. The third person of the Trinity is going to come and walk with you through life. To convict you of sin? Yes. To demand that we change from error? Yes. But one of the most beautiful things that was promised to us is the work of the Spirit would guide us into all truth. Not just to have the head knowledge, though that is necessary, but we would have a heart change. Guys, you know what? You're in dangerous territory every time you sit under the preaching of God's word. You say, "Oh, really, Rob?" Yeah. Because with knowledge in Christ comes the expectation, I'll do something with it. I know it's not enough. Oh, I wish I could tell you the whole book of James. Guys, just go read it. You say that you're a person of faith? Oh, yeah. Then show me your works. not to be saved, but as a result of salvation. Folks, it's never a righteousness of works that ever demands God ever giving me new birth. But as a result of the new birth, there are certain things that I am to be subject to, and one of them is obedience to do the work of the ministry which I have been called to do, i.e. preach the gospel. Three anchor points that we really need to lean into in order for us to understand this passage this morning. But I want to show you an overview of the Apostle Paul's life before I look at this morning's passage. I think it would be very healthy for us as Paul comes to the end of his life in 2 Timothy. I want you to take your scripture and go to chapter 4 of 2 Timothy, and I want to begin reading in verse 5. And I want to read down through verse 8. If somebody was going to say, Paul, would you just give a summary of your ministry, primarily in preaching the gospel to the Gentiles, to the pagans, to the false worshipers? What would you say your life looked like as you were just summing it up? What would your tombstone read as you are entering into those latter moments? Because Paul knew that when he wrote 2 Timothy, this more than likely was the end of the road. It's interesting that in the early ministry of Timothy, he writes 1 Timothy. In the latter part of Paul's life, he writes to him again. And listen how he frames his life. Man, this ought to be encouragement for everybody in this room that's born again. Verse 5, but you, speaking to Timothy, be sober in all things, under the control of the work of the Spirit. You be in right mindset, and your actions be in right step, in right character. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. These are not suggestions. These are commandments. Guys, we have to get past this as being a yield sign. This is a stop sign. We must act. But listen to how he frames his life. Verse 6. For I am, the Apostle Paul, am already being poured out as a drink offering. My days are numbered. I'm being poured out. I'm at the bottom of the jug. And here's what my life looks like. And the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but listen, Timothy, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Folks, if you ever wanted a promise about life, there it is. You, under the subjugation of the one who called you, lean into, by faith, to live your life unto him. And when you get to the latter part and you're dipping your toe in the grave that's set before you, you can say, I finished, and I finished well. Why? I did what he said for me to do, and I did it with a heart of pleasure. It was my desire. Guys, we've even caught and captured this even in the secular world. Just go to Chick-fil-A. What do they tell you when you say thank you? My pleasure. Every time, it's like clockwork. You can tell they are so well-versed. I can't believe it. 106 degrees giving me an unsweet lemonade is their pleasure through a window. I don't think so, but they are so ingrained, and they are so trained. Thank you. Oh, my pleasure. I mean, you can't even hardly get it out of your mouth, and they're pleasuring you. Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure. Did you know that that's the Christian walk? He says, I've endured hardship. This appointment has cost me everything. Paul never married. He never knew this right here. The beauty of having offspring and offspring having offspring, and just the beauty of the blessing of living in a community of family. But he had the brethren. In the midst of his life, he doesn't one time say, and I've suffered hardship, and I sure wish I wouldn't have done this. Oh, I wish I could have just been the council as a Sanhedrin. It just led people right to the place of hell. I wish my life would have never measured for anything and would have counted for nothing. He said, no, I finished. I fought. I lived strong. Timothy, what does your life mean? What does it count for? The older I get, I wonder. In my own life. Did you know for the last 3.5 weeks, 4 weeks, I've had to wrestle with this passage every single day because this is what I'm saying is my call. And there's 11 characteristics by the time we get to verse 16 that I've been appointed to. And if I had to take out a clean sheet of paper and clear my desk off and I had to answer 11 questions about my personal character and excellency, would I pass? And not in your eyes. Please, and there's no neglect or I'm not being condescending to you, but would I in the eyes of God be an excellent minister according to his definition? Guys, I care for you guys, but I care little about what you think about me. I care more about what he thinks about me. Because one of these days, I don't go to an appellate court to give an account of the way I minister to you at this church. I go right to the throne. And I will have to stand before him one day. And I will have to give an account of these days like this. And he's not going to ask me, well, what do you think Bob thought about you? Think Sarah was okay with it? And not that he doesn't care about Bob and Sarah. He's going to say, this is how you lived your life. And folks, it's not in condemnation. I'm not going to be fearful on that day. But man, I don't want to smell like smoke either. So Timothy has laid a charge today. And I want you to see that the verb tenses mean something today. They're very weighty. I'm going to say this once, not to impress, but to set the focus. They are... active, perfect, present, tense, imperatives. That means that I'm actively involved, habitually, continually living in a commandment sent by God. That's what it means. This is not a one-time shot. This is who I am. This is the tapestry of my life. And I'm actively bending the knee. I'm obeying it because it's the right thing to do. All right. Four things this morning. Beginning in verse 13, I'm going to read the text down through verse 16, and then we're going to look at four aspects, and they break nicely by the four verses. And so I'll try to give you the headers as we go. I usually forget, and so forgive me. You can come look at my notes when it's over. Beginning in verse 13, until I come again, give attention to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation and teaching. Do not neglect the spiritual gift within you, which was bestowed upon you through prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by the presbytery. Take pains with these things. Be absorbed in them so that your progress may be evident to all men. Verse 16. Pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Persevere in these things, for as you do this, you will assure salvation both for yourself and for those who hear you. Father, thank you for this time together. For the presence of the work of the Spirit. And Father, as we've confessed every single Sunday, we cannot know any of this outside of your provision of your amazing grace. So not only do we want to know, we want to act in it, that we might be found faithful in our calling to salvation and to the spread of the gospel. So Father, if you would just teach us today, we'd be quick to give you the praise. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. All right, I want you to see verse 13 first because it sets the time of really the focus of really the remainder of the four verses. And we're going to frame it around this. Excellent ministry is always based in biblical truth. It is a priority of practice. So I know you guys have done this, and I've talked to you about this before, but you've changed jobs, or you've started a new job, or an aspect of your job may have changed. Right, Jeff? And a company comes in, a different protocol, a different system, a different priority. And what they do, more than likely, more than not, they're going to give you new role and responsibility, so that you have a clear checklist of what you're about. That doesn't mean you like it. It just means you understand it. I'm going to ask you to do this. I know you did this last year, but I'm going to add this, or I'm going to take this away, and you're going to have new roles and responsibility. All right, so this is exactly what Paul does with Timothy. He says, I want you to frame this around, this is the priority. This is what's most significant. This is what you really need to put your labor and your time in. This is interesting, because what we do, even expectations from parishioners, but especially from ministers, we oftentimes get out of balance. We spend too much time in visitation and too much time in counseling and too much time in meeting certain needs. Not that those things are not important. Please don't walk out of here and say, Rob doesn't care about those things. We just need to neglect people. That is not what I said. I said we get out of balance. We will spend more time in priority of things that aren't really the priority of Scripture according to the excellency of ministry that God has defined. And so he just does a check and balance for Timothy. He says, okay, if I'm going to prioritize your day, this is really where you need to spend the majority of your time, and this is what you really need to be about, and all the rest of that stuff will fall into place. But this is where your heart needs to be. This is where your priority of desire needs to be. But he prefaces it with a few things that I want you to draw your attention to. Until I come. You ever had that? All right, when I get back. This is my dad. When I get back, I want those things done that I gave you. Well, if he doesn't come back and there's no accountability, then probably not going to get them done. Paul looks at Timothy and he says, look, here's the desire of my heart. I want to come to the field at Ephesus and I want to be with you. But until I come, these are the things that you need to, look at the very next line, pay attention to. These are the priorities that you need to hold to first. This is of the utmost. This is premier. Because I've been told that too. When I get back, I want these things done. And if you get a chance and you finish those, then do these things. Those do these things are an addition to. Those aren't the things that have to be done. That's if I finish the priority items. Well, eight of those characteristics all need to be done, but we have a priority of pay attention. It's like this. Hey, when your mom did that to you, and then would take you by her finger under the chin and lift your head up and go, by your full name, Robbie D. And you're like, oh gosh, this is seismic. There's going to be some weight behind this one. That's exactly what Paul does to Timothy. Hey, up here, Timothy, whatever your middle name is, pay attention. I anticipate coming back, and this is what I want to find you doing. Well, what is it then? It's of greatest priority. We look at it, the centrality of focus is the Bible. Wow, check this out. Until I come, give attention to three things. Public reading of Scripture, exhortation, and teaching. Guys, you ever wonder why we do what we do when we gather together as a church? Is it just this has always been our habit? Or this is really the way our denomination is always done? Or is there some motivation to do what we do? Guys, how do we open every service after the announcements? The public reading of God's Word. What do we do before every message is preached? The public reading of God's Word. Guys, if it doesn't matter and it doesn't matter to God, then why do we do those things? He says, look, I'm going to come and there's going to be an accountability. And Timothy, if I walked in on a Sunday morning as the church is gathered at Ephesus, what are you going to be doing in priority? Okay, let me get this right. We're going to publicly read Scripture. Yeah. What's the next thing I need to hear you? do. I need to hear you in expository preaching around Scripture, exhortation. And immediately we like to look at the side flip of exhortation, that it's encouragement. It is encouragement, but it's also at times rebuke, correction, understanding. When you preach the full counsel of God's word, that is exhortation. Don't you neglect the reading, the public reading of God's word. Guys, they had pieces and parts of the Old Testament. That's all they had. They didn't have this canonized from 66 books, part in the old, part in the new. They had portions. They didn't even have the whole of Scripture. Most of them would have pieces of the law, the first five books of the Bible, and they would stand up and sometimes read the same Scripture over and over. Does it matter? It matters to God. Because when we publicly read God's Word, we are expressing who He is. This is not a book about God. This is God. This is not somebody writing on behalf. You say, well, I thought Paul penned that. Yeah, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to tell you who authored this book. God Himself authored this. You want to know who God is? Read the book. You want to know how you ought to live unto God? Read the book. Quit looking for some divine revelation outside of this. There's not any. He is complete in His Word. Publicly read it. Stand before the congregation. Read the Bible. Exhort them. But then look at that little last tag. Didasco. Teach the Word. Ah. Can I tell you there's a two-way road that Paul has anticipated in the assembly that gathers at Ephesus? They are going to be taught the word as hearers. And then they're going to be with anticipation, knowing something's going to be done about what they've been taught. Can I just tell you something? I can't teach you if I'm not a student of the word. Guys, by the good grace of God, I never want to get up here and wing it. I don't want to go to somebody else's notes and just take it. Though sometimes those things are handy, sometimes those things bring clarity. Commentaries are not in themselves evil. I'm not saying that. But if God has not inspired this message through the study and seeking in the Word in my private life, it is very little value to me or to you. He says, here's the thing I want you to pay attention to. I want you to lean into this. This is what I want you to grasp to. Publicly read Scripture. Okay. Exhort the people as you read it. Oh, and teach them. Guys, there was an anticipation as a teacher when I was in public school. For every time I taught a lesson, you know what the expectation was? We would do something with it, and when called upon, you would be able to recall it because you invested in it. You studied it likewise. You know why it's so important that God Himself, through the eyes of those first century believers in the book of Acts, brought a significant understanding of what nobility was? You know what's noble in the sight of God? Is that you take what the priest told you and you check it out to make sure it's right. You know what that ensures? One, correction if necessary, accountability always, but it ensures that you're going to be studying God's word around His word. That's a promise. It is hard for you to check out what I say if you don't go check out what I say. And if I said that it's in the Bible, you have to take the Bible to see if it's true. That's the study of God's word. That's nobility. That's what the Bereans were accounted unto their character. They're more noble than all the rest because they don't just listen to what the preacher says and then go live however they want to. They check it out to see it's above God. priority, pay attention. So first and foremost, verse 13 teaches us that excellency in ministry is centrality of focus around the Bible. Priority of practice. Secondly, verse 14, practices in excellency in ministry, spiritual gifts given by God. Look at it in verse 14. Do not, again, that's not a suggestion, that's a command. Do not in any way, you've heard this before by people that have really leaned into you, parents, grandparents, don't do that. Hey, up here, pay attention, don't do that. Don't go there, don't say that, don't act that way. That's what he's doing. Do not. And then he has a negative. Neglect the spiritual gift within you. Do not, one, take for granted, and secondly, really abuse the gift. Turn your back on it. Make it of no use in your life because you're not practicing it. Folks, you know how many times I've looked at athletes and thought in my mind, you have every tool known to man. You are so gifted, but you are so lazy. You're always late to practice. You don't want to stay the whole time. So your mom checks you out for some bogus reason, and I get some note from somebody that's supposed to prove to me you got to leave practice every day early. And you've always got an excuse that you can't work hard enough, and so you've always got a limp. But come Friday night when we don the uniform and kick the lights on, you're 100%, but you don't know any of the plays. So it's hard for me to use you. Folks, did you know that in the exercise of faith in the ministry, you can do the same thing? God has granted to every believer at least a single gift. But Timothy had multiple gifts by God. And Paul looks at him and says, here's what I want you to do. Don't do this. Don't neglect the gift that God has given you as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't do that. And then he gives him the reason why and why it was recognized. Look at this. Look at the end of 14. Do not neglect the spiritual gift within you. That's the operation. That's the powerhouse. That's the drive. It's a God thing, which was bestowed or granted to you through prophetic utterance. That's God's appointing. That's God's commissioning. Which comes first, the prophetic or men? Yeah. First starts with God, the prophetic utterance. This is a God thing, Timothy. But look at the end. It's a man thing too, because we just acted in obedience. Prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by who? The presbytery, the council of elders. Folks, they were only acting in what God had already done in you. They were just saying, hey, that a boy, go get him. We see what God has done in your life, and we stand behind you, and we support you 100%. You go get it, boy. But it's because God did it in you. So where do you get that? All right, I want to show you. Go to 2 Timothy in chapter 1. This is great. If you ever wondered where Paul got his contract to do what he was doing, Timothy has the same contract. Beginning in verse 5. I wish I had time to read it all, but verse 5. For I, Paul, am mindful of the sincere faith within you. That's saving faith. You're a born-again believer. What was the first call on Timothy's life? His salvation. Then what happens? Which first dwelt with your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. And I'm sure, that's an absolute, I am sure that it is with you as well. Folks, does it matter as a grandparent or a parent what you say and what you do around your kids or your grandkids? Does it matter? Does it matter? I'm telling you, it matters. Can I just say that Timothy, on his ledger of understanding of his appointment, was first by the dynamic call of the giftedness in salvation to one be a born-again child. And secondly, he was gifted as a minister of the gospel. But he had influences past Paul. He had influences past Ephesus. He had influences at home. His grandmama must have busted out the Bible and said, "Thus saith the Lord." His mama must have set him down at the breakfast table and said, "Before we have breakfast, we're going to read a portion of Scripture, and there is going to be our powerhouse. That's going to be the battery by which we move in life." He says, "Listen, let's just say the council of the presbytery, the elders, didn't lay hands on you. They didn't support you. I want to tell you two people that have invested in you greatly. And don't you ever forget it. You had a grandmama and you had a mama that cared about your spiritual growth. They couldn't save you. Salvation is of God. But they poured into you God's word." And then he says this at the end. "And I'm absolutely sure that's why you are what you are. God saved you. I appointed you. And I put people in your path that told you the truth." Oh, man. Guys, as our country deteriorates in the family, so goes our nation. It's not about who we vote for, though that's important. When the family falls apart, our nation is done. I don't care if they want to get up or not. I told you that the test for not going to church when I was growing up, you had to break 102 fever. 101, you didn't go to Sunday school. You sat by mama. Anything less than 101, you went to Sunday school and enjoyed it. If you had 101, you might be able to lean over on my mom during the service as hot as a little skunk and go to sleep. But every other time, you were wide awake because you're getting this. Stay with us. Stay with us. The flick of the ear kept you going. Okay, I'd really like to nod off, but that hurts. Are you sick? I don't feel good. We need to take your temperature. I feel all right. Because we didn't do the one by mouth. That was saved for during the week. Sunday mornings is a whole different deal. I don't think you're that sick. Guys, I'm telling you, they didn't save me. My parents didn't save me. Don't hear me say that. But I can't tell you how grateful I am that they cared enough to tell me the truth. They read it to us as kids. And when I heard God call me at the age of 19, I wasn't afraid of God. I knew I desperately needed him, but I wasn't afraid of him. You know why? Because my father spoke highly of him every single day. And my mom praised his mercy and grace every day. Because you know how they would end the prayer? Every time one of them would pray. "In the precious name of Jesus, I offer this prayer." Not just any name, but the precious name of Jesus. "Grant us today our request." It matters. It mattered in Timothy's life, and it matters in your life. The realm of influence that God gives us does not need to be neglected, but neither does our gift. Thirdly, I want you to see in verse 15 that the portion of Scripture that drives the change in our life is found in 15. Take pains. That means it's going to sting at times. It's going to cost you. You really, with all of your heart, mind, soul, spirit, give heed to this. Take pains with these things. Be absorbed, that's saturated in them, so that you progress. Sanctification may be evident to all. third act that Paul is charging young Timothy with, excellent ministry, is operated by and in sanctification. Continual growth. Guys, I wish I could tell you that there's a point in minister's life or in believer's life where you arrive and you say, okay, man, I got it now. I don't need to study. I don't need to be challenged anymore. I don't need to be held accountable anymore. Paul would even tell the church at Philippi, not that I have arrived, but I'm on a journey of growth. And until I breathe my last, I want to be different today than I was yesterday for Christ. He looks at this young man and he uses two words that you ought to mark in your Bible: pain and absorb. It'll cost you, but I want you to be dripping in the gospel. I want you to be totally absorbed in it. Literally, what it means is, I want it to absorb all of you. That whenever life ends and life is wringed out of you, what drips out is Jesus Christ. And when the pain of life and the vice of life squeezes you, what comes out of you is Jesus Christ. Excellent ministry is based around sanctification. Justification is a past act, one time, of God. Sanctification is present tense, is ongoing. Glorification is a future hope of things to come. He says, your sanctification. Now I want to show you what he does with it. So this is a controversial passage if you don't keep it in context. The last thing I want you to see is verse 16. To scrutinize personal life and public life. This is a conclusion of exhortation. Pay close attention. All right. Until I come, give attention. Do not neglect. Take pains with these things. Pay close attention. That's like he heaped on. Okay, I've asked you to, you know, give attention to this. I've asked you to lean into this. I've asked you to hold to this. Now I'm going to take it one notch further. I want you to pay close attention to this because there's something at stake and there's promises to follow. Look at it. Pay close attention to, first, yourself. Secondly, in yourself, to what you teach. Persevere in these things. Be long-suffering. Endure these things. In patience, endure. Be long-suffering. Be persevering in these things. Why? See that little word for? Here's the promise and here's the purpose. For as you do this, what? Pay close attention to yourself in your teaching. As you do this, you will. This is not maybe. This is not could. This is an absolute. You will ensure the promise of salvation both for yourself and for those who hear you. Guys, I can't tell you enough how important it is that we only teach the Word of God when we gather. And when you study, that your primary focus is God's Word. He says, I want to one-up this. I want you to pay close attention to what I'm fixing to tell you. All right, here's how it is literally. This is really in culture a picture of how a rabbi used to teach his students. And he would sit like this, and his students would be right here, gathered around his feet, and he would teach. If there was a student in the group that either needed to hear for correction, reproof, or needed to be encouraged, this is what the rabbi would do. Johnny, come here. Sit up here by me. And he would put his arm around this young student, and he'd say, all of you can hear this, but Johnny, I want to speak to you for just a second. This is for you. Listen to me. I want you to pay close attention to what I'm going to tell you, Timothy. There's life at stake. this is not funny business. This is not trivial. This is not elementary. Timothy, come up here and sit with me. Listen to me. Your sanctification is directly in correlation of growth to what you do with the teaching of God's Word. Timothy, have you heard me today? Yeah, Paul. How did you hear me? Well, I read the letter. What are you going to do about it? I'm going to pay close attention to it. Hearing the Word of God is not an anatomical gonging in your ear. It comes with anticipation of obedience. Oh, if I've said this one time in messages, I've said it a million times. God is not nearly as concerned about your comfort as He is about your obedience. He doesn't care if you're comfortable in it. You can get happy, and I pray that you will have a heart of joy, and I pray that it will be your desire one day. But until you get there, just do what I'm telling you. This is about your sanctification. This is about your growth. Practice and operate in it. You'll one day be overwhelmed with joy in it. Folks, I wish I could tell you that I enjoyed every minute of ministry, especially when I first started. I didn't. I was terrible at it. I still am. But man, this is how bad it was. I did my first funeral, and it was time for me to go to the casket. We had a viewing, and I hear this from the site. Well, when I was growing up, it means that somebody was trying to get my attention. So I look over to the side, and there's the funeral director going, "Wrong end. Go to the other end of the casket. You're at the wrong end." I'm like, does that matter? Evidently it did. So I went to this end, and they popped it open. Well, there's his head. I'm like, oh, guess I need to be up here. Didn't realize there was an end that I needed to be standing at. Did you know that that's just protocol? I didn't know that. I had no idea. So I'm thinking, okay, somebody should have told me that, right? There should have been a class or something. There was. There was a guy standing over going, wrong end. Go to the other end. If I'd have gone, it doesn't matter. I'd have been standing there by the guy's feet while their family's going by, and they would have just exited in front of me. I would never spoke a word of encouragement to a single one of them. Guys, there's some system. There's some protocol. I didn't know them. There's certain things about Timothy he just doesn't know, but Paul does. There's certain things that Paul doesn't know, but God does. All of this works in harmony. You pay attention to the teaching of God's Word, and you will grow up to be a mature Christian. That's the promise of God. Folks, you're not going to make it any other way in sanctification. You say, well, I've been born again. It doesn't matter. It does matter, because this is how we live. But listen, it's not just for me. Look at the passage. It's for you too. Guys, if we're not growing under the preaching of God's Word, then I'm not studying. Really? What does it say? Ensure salvation for both yourself and for those who hear you. Guys, at the end of any tenure of a minister, if that minister honestly looks at the Word of God and the people did not grow in faith, then he did not do his job. Because that's a promise of Scripture. If you walk out today and say, well, Rob's been there 3 years, I haven't learned a single thing. Guys, that's probably the arrow to the heart that I don't want to hear. Because it means I didn't study. And your responsibility means you didn't do anything with it when you heard it. See that pay attention to the teaching? That's a two-way street. Rob, you're going to grow, and the people are going to grow. Just do what it says in Scripture. 11 characteristics of an excellent minister. And categorically, you can put them in one of two categories. And then I'm going to quit. One is personal life. The inner man. Excellence in characterized in Scripture, defined by the Word, is that the minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ cares about their internal growth, their walk personally with God. The second in category of excellency is my public life. Folks, I can tell you guys all day long that I'm a born-again believer, but if you don't see it, you don't believe it. If I live like the world and I talk like the world and I walk like the world, then you're going to say, then you're worldly. You guys have heard this probably from birth and nursery rhyme. If it walks like a duck and talks like a duck and looks like a duck, it's probably a duck. You know, the excellency of character that is defined in Scripture is a man of God who will take care of the heart condition. How? Studying His Word. And then once God has revealed the Word, He'll just live in public what He's been instructed to do in private. You know what I'm afraid of today in the Western world religiosity? We have it backwards. We care more about what we look like on the outside, never having been spending any time in the investment of God's Word, and we wonder why our life is such a shamble and no one believes us. Let it not be said of us, a Fellowship Church of Ballinger, that having heard the Word of God, we chose to neglect it and walk away. But we heard it with the intent, I want to be found faithful. Use me. Folks, will it be perfect? Oh, you know, people say, well, Rob, do you ever listen to your messages? Oh, my goodness, no. Guys, I hear right here what's coming out. I'm not going to sit through torture listening to it again. One, I sound like Mickey Mouse. No, I don't listen to them again. I get plenty in studying doing this. But here's what I do want to listen to. God teaching me. And you know what I want you to listen to? God teaching you. And then all of us leave this place on a day like this, and we act just like our Father, the Lord God Almighty. Father, we thank You for this day and for, Father, just framing the thought of what is life really about and what do we need to prioritize. And very clear in excellency in ministry is public reading of Your Word, exhortation of the Word, wherever that falls, whatever is necessary, and then just flat teaching it. Get up, teach it, express it, sit down. So for those things, we are grateful that You made it clear, made it easy for us to understand. I pray that, Father, today we'd be changed by Your Scripture, the exhortation of the Word, and the teaching of its truth. We love You and thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Rob. Another great message. So happy Rob joins us. Thoroughly enjoy his teaching. All right. Well, if you'll stand and sing with us, we're going to end up with a Shout to the Lord.
Jesus. the sun.